Okay, so let us continue with our discussion. So let me remind you where we were at the end of the last lecture. So we had taken X Riemann surface with covering the complex plane. Okay, so of course this implies that if I call the covering as if I call the covering map as P from C to X, since the complex plane is simply connected, this is also the universal covering. So this implies it's a universal covering for X. Okay, and if I fix a point small x in capital X, then you know that the fundamental group of capital X based at small x can be identified with the Dirac transformation group of the covering, and the Dirac transformation group is a subgroup of the holomorphic automorphisms of the universal cover, which in this case is the complex plane. And this the automorphisms, the holomorphic automorphisms of the complex plane are upper triangular Mobius transformations, those Mobius transformations which when represented in matrix form are upper triangular. So they will be given by this kind of matrices. So AD equal to 1, and of course you have to go mod plus or minus the identity matrix, the subgroup, two element subgroup. Okay, in fact what happens is that the Dirac transformation group actually lands even in a smaller subgroup than this, namely the subgroup of translations. That's because you know that any Dirac transformation cannot have fixed points unless it is the identity transformation. Okay, it cannot have even a single fixed point. Therefore, if you take a non-trivial Dirac transformation, it should be a Mobius transformation that goes from C to C and has no fixed point. Okay, and of course, as a general Mobius transformation, it should fix infinity, the point at infinity. So it has to be a translation. Okay, so the moral of the story is there is the subgroup, the subgroup of translations, which is which can be written actually in the form 1 b 0 1 b in C. This is a subgroup here. Okay, and this is actually the this is just the set of translations by complex numbers. Okay, where of course translation by B is just the map that sends Z to Z plus B. Okay, and the image of this will actually land inside this. Okay, so this this image here, what you will get is it will this the image of the subgroup will actually land inside this subgroup. Okay, and you know, I can further identify this with I can identify this with complex numbers by just sending T sub B to B. Okay, so you just send T sub B to B, and of course T sub B is being thought of as the Mobius transformation. It is a Mobius transformation Z going to Z plus B, which has this matrix representation given by 1 B 0 1. Okay, so and this will give you an isomorphism of groups, and of course here it's going to be a group under addition, and therefore first of all the first observation that one makes is that pi 1 has to be abelian. Okay, because it the pi 1 is a subgroup of this group of translations, and translations commute with one another, and therefore this is an abelian group, and therefore pi 1 is abelian. So this condition that x is a Riemann surface with universal covering C automatically forces that the fundamental group of x has to be abelian, okay. So image of pi 1 of capital X comma small x in C comma plus, let the image be equal to G, okay, let us call it as G. Of course we get this pi 1 of x has to be abelian. Okay, and what else did we see last time? Last time we proved that this G, which is a subset of complex numbers, it's a subgroup under addition. Okay, this G is actually as a set of complex numbers, it is discrete. Okay, so G is discrete, and another thing that we also noticed was that G is a Z submodule of C. That is, if a translation, if you take an element of G which corresponds to a translation, then all integer multiples of, if you compose a translation so many times, okay, you are going to just get another translation which is integer multiples of translation by integer multiple of the original number. Okay, so what I am saying is, if T sub B is in G, then T sub n times B is also in G, which is just T sub B composed n times, assuming n is positive. Okay, of course if n is negative, then you have to compose T minus B, T sub minus B minus n times. Okay, and of course T sub B composed 0 times is to be taken as T sub 0, which is just the identity map, right. So G is a discrete Z submodule of C. Okay, we have seen this, and then I was telling you about this lemma, which says that there are only 3 possibilities for G. Number 1, of course, is a trivial possibility that G is just the zero group, the trivial group. That means it consists of only the identity mapping. Okay, translation by 0. Okay, the second thing is G is just integer multiples of a single non-zero complex number, omega, a non-zero complex number. Okay, and then the third possibility is that G is integer. It's an integer linear combination of 2 complex numbers, where both the complex numbers are non-zero, and their ratio is not a real number. That means they are linearly independent as elements of linearly independent over R, over real, over reals, as elements of the field of complex numbers. Okay, so these are the only 3 possibilities. Okay, and so let's try to establish this proof. So the first thing I want to say is, of course, let's assume G is not 0. Okay, if G is not equal to 0, okay, we look at the set of all Z in C such that mod Z is less than or equal to capital R intersection G. Okay, which is non-empty for R large enough. Okay, so if G is not 0, then G has some element. So all you have to do is you have to choose capital R greater than the modulus of that element, and then this intersection will contain that element. Okay, so there is you can choose R sufficiently large so that this is non-empty. Okay, now the point is that this intersection will turn out to be finite. okay. The point is that this intersection will turn out to be finite. Why is that so? That is because first of all note that G in C is closed, okay. The set of points G is closed because you know you get the closure of a set by adding to the set accumulation points, okay, but G has no accumulation points, G is just a discrete set, okay. So G is equal to its closure, so it is closed, okay. So the G is a closed set as it has no accumulation points, in C, that is what we proved last time, that is how we proved G is discrete, okay. And then this set here, this is just a disk of radius less than or equal to R, it is a closed disk, so it is a closed set, okay. It is already, this is also a closed set of the complex, closed subset of the complex plane, this is an intersection of two closed sets and therefore it is closed, okay. So this set of all Z in C such that mod Z less than or equal to R intersection G is closed, okay, but it is obviously bounded because it is a subset of this closed disk of bounded radius, so it is closed and bounded and therefore you can conclude that it is compact, okay. So it is also bounded, hence compact. Therefore it is a compact set, okay. Now you see, take every point, see every point of G is an isolated point, so you can find a small disk surrounding that point, which open disk if you want surrounding that point that does not contain any other points of G, okay. Now you take all those disks corresponding to the points in this intersection, that will be an open cover for this intersection, but it is compact, so there must be a finite subcover and that will force that this has to be finite, okay. So since so let me write that here, since G is discrete, consists only of isolated points, this set of all Z in C such that mod Z less than or equal to R intersection G is finite, it is a finite set. In fact you know that this closed disk is compact, okay, and you know that if you take any infinite subset it should have an accumulation point, so that will also, that is also another way of saying that this intersection has to be finite, okay. So it is finite, so what I can do is I can choose a member here which is closest to the origin, okay, it is a finite set of complex numbers, okay, and it is non-empty, okay, and it contains a non-zero complex number, okay, because G, I have assumed G is not 0, so and you know I have chosen R in such a way so that there is at least one non-zero complex number in this set G, okay. So I can choose a complex number in this intersection such that it has minimum modulus, okay, and let me call that as omega 1. So let omega 1 be an element in this set with mod omega 1 not equal to 0 and mod omega 1 minimum, because it is a finite set I can of course choose one such element, okay. Now omega 1 is an element of G, this implies Z dot omega 1 will also be a subset of G, okay, that is because G is a Z submodule of C, alright. And of course if Z dot omega 1 is equal to G we are done, we have come to case 2, okay. So if Z dot omega 1 is equal to G we are done, so assume z dot omega 1 is properly contained in G, okay. Then I will have to show that we will be in the third case, okay, of the lemma, all right. So if this is true, again we play the same game. We play the same game. What you do is consider the set. Again, you take the set of all z in C, such that mod z is get less than or equal to some r prime now, and intersect it with G minus the complement of z dot omega 1 in G. Okay. So what is this set? This is all those elements of G which are not an integer multiple of omega 1, okay, that is what this set is, and then I am intersecting it with this closed disk, okay. And since there are elements of G which are not integer multiples of omega 1, this is a non-empty set, and therefore if I choose r prime sufficiently large, this intersection will be non-empty, okay. So consider the set which is non-empty for r prime sufficiently large. Okay, consider this set. Now again the same argument will tell you that this set is also finite. Why? Because you see the what will happen is that you see this is a G is discrete, okay, every subset of a discrete set is continues to be discrete, and so this is a discrete set in this closed and bounded disk, okay, so it has to be finite. And of course again the argument will be, if it were not finite, then you know every infinite subset of a compact set like this will contain an accumulation point, but we know G has no accumulation points, therefore this has to be again finite set, okay. This has to be again a finite set. This has to be again a finite set, all right. Choose omega 2 in this set, so that you know omega 2 is not 0 and modulus of omega 2 is minimum. Okay. Now in this set you choose an omega 2, which means you know it is an element of G which is not an integer multiple of omega 1, okay, and of course since there are only finitely many, I choose one with minimum modulus that I can do, alright. Of course omega 2 is non-zero. Now I am going to show that G is actually z omega 1 plus z omega 2. Okay, that's what I'm going to prove. So, firstly, we claim that omega 2 by omega 1, okay, is not a real number. Okay, the first claim I'm making is that omega 2 by omega 1 is not a real number. For if it were, then there would exist an integer. There would exist an integer n with you know n strictly less than omega 2 by omega 1, strictly less than n plus 1. You can get this. See, if you have a real number, then of course it has to lie in some interval, okay. And you will have strict inequality here because omega 2 is not an integer multiple of omega 1, okay. Omega, you cannot have n equal to omega 2 by omega 1 because that will mean omega 2 is n times omega 1, that is not possible because omega 2 has been chosen outside of integer multiples of omega 1, and for the same reason omega 2 by omega 1 cannot also be equal to n plus 1, okay. So these two are both strict inequalities, but this will immediately give you a contradiction. That is because you see what will happen is, you know, if I consider 1 by mod omega 1 times modulus of n omega 1 minus omega 2, if I calculate this, okay, then this will be this will be modulus of n minus omega 2 by omega 1, okay. And you see of course n minus omega 2 by, but omega 2 by omega 1 is greater than n, so this will be actually be omega 2 by omega 1 minus n, that is what it will be, because omega 2 by omega 1 is a real number greater than n, alright. And of course you see, but anyway this is lying in an interval of length 1, therefore this has to be less than 1, okay, so this is less than 1. So what this will tell you is that it will tell you n omega 1 minus omega 2 is strictly less than omega mod omega 1, okay, that is what it will tell you. It will tell you n omega 1 minus omega 2 is strictly less than mod omega 1, but you see this, the this element, this belongs to G, okay. So what you have done is you have found an element of G whose modulus is less than mod omega 1, but mind you mod omega 1 was chosen with minimum modulus, okay, mod omega 1 was chosen with minimum modulus. See it does not, see once I have chosen mod omega 1, I can still increase R, I can let R to go to infinity, it is not going to change the choice of this mod omega 1, okay. So mod omega 1 is kind of smallest, it's one with smallest modulus, but you see now I have gotten hold of an element of G with modulus lesser than mod omega 1, that is a contradiction, okay. So contradicts choice of omega 1, okay. So this contradiction will tell you that omega 2 by omega 1 cannot be real, okay. So omega 2 by omega 1 is not a real number, okay. So you get that. Now the next thing is the moment omega 2 by omega 1 is not a real number, it means that omega 1 and omega 2 are, they form a basis for the complex numbers as a vector space over real numbers, because you see they are since the ratio is not real, they are linearly independent over R, okay. And it is linearly independent, there are two elements, and the dimension of the complex numbers as a field over the real numbers is two dimensional. So the moment you have a linearly independent set with cardinality equal to the dimension, it has to be a basis, okay. So so this will imply that you know omega 1 comma omega 2 is an R basis for complex number C as a vector space over R, as vector space over R, okay. Now so what does that implies, every complex number can be is a unique linear combination, a unique R linear combination of omega 1 and omega 2, that is what basis means. Every element can be expressed as a linear combination of omega 1 and omega 2, and the coefficients of omega 1 and omega 2 are unique, okay. So but this happens for every complex number, so it also happens for every element of G, after all G is a subset of complex numbers. So this implies if you take a small g in capital G, then G has to be writable in the form lambda 1 omega 1 plus lambda 2 omega 2, where lambda I are real numbers, okay. I should be able to write any element of G in this form, okay, as a real linear combination of omega 1 and omega 2, and the coefficients lambda 1 and lambda 2 are unique, that is because of linear independence of omega 1 and omega 2, okay. Now again lambda 1 and lambda 2 are real numbers, okay, so I can choose for both lambda 1 and lambda 2, I choose an integer that is closest to lambda 1, and I choose an integer that is closest to lambda 2, okay. So I will write that down, choose m1 comma m2 integers with modulus of lambda 1 minus m1 less than or equal to half, modulus of lambda 2 minus m2 less than or equal to half. I can do this. Of course you see lambda 1 is a real number, it has to lie in some interval, okay. So it's an interval with integer endpoints, okay. So if it lies to the closer to the left end point, you take that as your M1, okay. If it lies closer to the right end point, you take that as your M2. In any case, you can get M1, M2 with these bounds, all right. Then and once I do this, and now I want you to look at G minus M1 omega 1 minus M2 omega 2. I want you to look at this difference, okay. This turns out to be lambda 1 minus M1 into omega 1 plus lambda 2 minus M2 into omega 2, okay, by our definition, all right. And now let's compute the modulus of this difference and try to use the triangle inequality, okay. So so modulus of G will be G minus M1 omega 1 minus M2 omega 2 will be modulus of lambda 1 minus M1 into omega 1 plus lambda 2 minus M2 into omega 2, okay. And now if I apply the triangle inequality, this is less than or equal to modulus of lambda 1 minus M1 omega 1 plus modulus of lambda 2 minus M2 into omega 2. I will get this by the triangle inequality, mod of a plus b less than or equal to mod a plus mod b, okay. And what I want to say is that I want to say that this is actually strictly a strict inequality. Why is this a strict inequality? Because you see, this is a strict inequality because you see mod of a plus b is equal to mod a plus mod b, okay, for two complex numbers a and b occurs only when a and b are real multiples of one another, okay. There is a collinearity condition for the three sides of a triangle that makes the triangle degenerate into a straight line, and then your triangle inequality becomes an equality. That is the only case, okay. So because this happens only when A is a real multiple of B, okay. So you know, if this doesn't happen, if there is equality, it will tell you that if there is an equality here, it will tell you this is a real multiple of that, okay. But then these are real coefficients, so it will tell you omega 1 is a real multiple of omega 2, but that contradicts the fact that the ratio omega 2 by omega 1 is not a real number, okay. Therefore this in this triangle inequality, this has to be a strict inequality, okay. So what I can write is that modulus of G minus M1 omega 1 minus M2 omega 2 is strictly less than mod lambda 1 minus omega 1 lambda 1 minus M1 times omega 1 plus mod lambda 2 minus M2 into omega 2, and this is strictly less than or equal to half mod omega 1 plus half mod omega 2. That is because mod lambda 1 minus M1 and mod lambda 2 minus M2 are each less than or equal to half, okay. Now you see, let us recall how omega 1 and omega 2 were chosen. Omega 1 was chosen to be an element of G with least modulus, which is non-zero, okay. And omega 2 was chosen to be again of least modulus, of course non-zero modulus, among those elements of G which are not integer multiples of omega 1, okay. Now therefore I can write that this is less than half omega 2 plus half omega 2, which is equal to omega 2, okay. And therefore you see this quantity on this element on the left side, G minus M1 omega 1 minus M2 omega 2, you see this cannot be an element of G which is not an integer multiple of omega 1, because if it were, then it would have modulus less than mod omega 2, which is against the choice of omega 2. Therefore, the conclusion is that this quantity has to be an integer multiple of omega 1, okay, and that will tell you that G is therefore an integer linear combination of omega 1 and omega 2. So let me write that down here. This is an element of G which has to be an integer multiple of omega 1. For if it is not an integer multiple of omega 1, then it will be an element with modulus less than that of omega 2, which is against the very choice of omega 2, okay. So it is an integer multiple of omega 1, that is, so if I write it down, I will get G is equal to G minus m1 omega 1 minus m2 omega 2 is actually say some n times omega 1, and this will tell you that G is actually m1 plus n times omega 1 plus m2 times omega 2, and in other words what you will get is therefore G is an integer multiple of omega 1 and omega 2, it is an integer linear combination of omega 1 and omega 2, and therefore you will get G is actually z dot omega 1 plus z dot omega 2 as we wanted, okay. So that finishes the proof of this claim that G is just the group of integer linear combinations of omega 1 and omega 2, okay. And of course you must realize that this is isomorphic to Z cross Z as a group under addition, okay. So that finishes the proof of the claim. Now what we are going to do is use this lemma to get all the results that we want. So what I will do is let me rub this off and look at each of these cases, okay. So so you see, remember that our situation was we had C to P, C to X, P is the covering map, this is the universal covering, this was our situation. If G is 0, okay, if G is 0, then what happens? See, if G is 0, that means pi 1 of X, capital X comma small x is 0. After all, G is the image of pi 1, okay. If you remember, pi 1, the fundamental group of the base was identified with the Deck transformation group. The Deck transformation group was identified with the subgroup of translations, and the image of the Deck transformation group is what we had called as G. G is isomorphic to pi 1, okay. G is just the image, isomorphic image of pi 1. So if G is 0, then pi 1 is 0. If pi 1 is 0, it means X is simply connected, and you know if X is simply connected, then you know X to X itself, the identity mapping itself is a covering map, and you know by the uniqueness property of universal coverings, it will tell you that X has to be holomorphic to C, okay. So then X is simply connected, so X to X identity map is a universal covering, and this will imply that therefore you know C to P is isomorphic to the covering given by the identity map, and this will imply that X is holomorphic to C, okay. So so if G is 0, okay, so what we have proved is if the universal covering of X is C and if the fundamental group is 0, then that corresponds to this case, and then X has to be just C, okay. This is the simplest case, okay. Then of course you know what to expect in the other two cases, so let me write it down. So if g is z dot omega 1, okay, if g is z dot omega 1, then actually what it means is then pi 1 x comma x is identified with the deck transformation group of this covering, and this is just z times translation by omega, okay. Mind you, that is how we identified a deck transformation with a translation. We found that all possible deck transformations can only be translations, okay, and the complex number omega corresponds to translation by omega. So this is what it is. And then what happens, then what happens, we have that we have see the, let me recall another fact that I told you last time. See, we have C to P, C to X, this is the covering. I told you C to C modulo the deck transformation group, okay, of this cover, these two can be identified such that this diagram commutes. So in fact, you know, I told you that the if you take the fundamental group of the base space below, that gets identified with the subgroup of automorphisms of the base of the covering space, okay. That subgroup is nothing but the deck transformation group, and if you go modulo the deck transformation group, what you will get back can be identified with the base space, okay. So this can be identified with X, but then you know this is just C modulo z dot t omega, okay. And if you remember, this was C sub omega in one of our earlier examples. This is a Riemann surface structure on the cylinder defined by this non-zero complex number omega. So this is Riemann surface structure on a cylinder defined by omega not equal to zero. Okay. So what you're saying is that if the universal covering of X is C, and if the fundamental group is isomorphic to Z, okay, then we are in case 2, and your Riemann surface X is nothing but a holomorphic structure, namely a Riemann surface structure on the real cylinder, okay. So in fact, if you want, I'll say a real cylinder, on a real cylinder, okay. And in fact, you know, so this first tells you that X has to be just a Riemann surface structure on a cylinder. Then I gave you, if you go back and recall, I gave you a theorem saying that all these various holomorphic structures that you can get on a real cylinder, if you change omega, they all don't change, they are all the same, okay. So I made that statement also. So let's try to prove it. So what I want to say is that if you change omega here, okay, still this the various X you are going to get for different omega, okay, they are all going to be the same. In fact, I told you that there is one special representative that is given by the exponential map as a covering map from C to C star. I told you that was the special representative for all the Riemann surface structures on a real cylinder, okay. So let us try to prove that, okay, let us try to prove that. So first of all, what I want to say is that so I want to first make a, I want to make a remark. See, let us take from C to let me take the map from C to C star, okay, which is given by z going to exponential of 2 pi I z by omega, okay. Let us take this map. C to C star, z going to e power 2 pi I z by omega. I can divide by omega because omega is not 0, alright. Now what you can do is that you can easily check that this is a covering map, therefore it is a universal covering, okay. And you can check that the deck transformation group is just translation by integers, okay, because that is what see the kernel of this map is exactly the integers, okay, the kernel of this map is exactly the integers, alright. So when integer times omega, so what I want to say is that so let me write that down, check this is a covering map. Hence the universal covering, because the space above C is simply connected, you check that it is a covering map, okay. For this you just have to study the properties of the exponential function, is it f of z equal to e power z, okay. If you study properties of the exponential function you will see that mind you omega is a constant, omega is to be treated as a constant, z is a variable, alright. So properties of exponential map will tell you that this is a universal covering, alright. Then that is one thing you will get. The second thing is you can see that the Deck transformation group is just z dot translation by omega, that is translation by integer multiples of omega, okay, it is just translation by integer multiples of omega, okay. So if z is an integer multiple of omega, alright, then you can see that this is going to be this is going to be 1, okay, this is going to be 1. If z is n omega I will get e power 2 pi I n, that will be 1, alright. So so what these two things will tell you is that this is now that put together with this remark will tell you that C modulo z dot translation by omega is just C star, okay. So in other words what it will tell you is that x has to be just holomorphic to C star, okay. So so let me write that down, so so thus C to C star by this map can be identified with C to C mod z dot t sub omega, this is the group of integer translation by integer multiples of omega, this can be identified, okay. This is our map this is our map well if you want let me call this as this is P sub omega, okay, alright, and if I call this map as exp, alright, so this is still exp and this is P sub omega, okay. So what these two diagrams together will tell you is that this covering C, so it will first tell you that x is just is actually not only homeomorphic but it is actually holomorphically isomorphic to C star, okay, and it will tell you that C to x this universal covering is the same as this universal covering C to C star, okay. So therefore x is holomorphic, I mean biholomorphic, holomorphically isomorphic to C star, okay, x is holomorphically isomorphic to C star, right. In fact I told you that you can scale this omega and just make this map the exponential map which is just z going to e power 2 pi I z, that is what I gave as the canonical representative for all in the holomorphic isomorphism class for all these Riemann surfaces, okay. So let me explain how that happens, okay, because there is something, there is a little bit of covering theory that comes into the picture, okay. So let me make this claim CTX is isomorphic as covering spaces to C star Z going to exponential of 2 pi I Z, okay. So this is the statement that I made. You take all possible Riemann surface structures on a cylinder, then they are all isomorphic, and they are all isomorphic just to C star, okay. That is the theorem that I stated. And now I am saying that even at the covering space level, not only is X isomorphic to C star, holomorphically isomorphic, this covering itself is isomorphic to the exponential map, okay. So in fact I told you that this can be taken as a special representative for all these holomorphic structures on the cylinder, Riemann surface structures on a cylinder, okay. So let us see how this is true. So for this I am going to do something, there is a little bit of a discussion. So let us again go back to our let us go back to the topological category, okay. Let us take a covering, let us take a topological space X, okay. Now so do not confuse this X with our X, forget our X for the present. Let us assume that we have a topological universal covering, okay, and you fix this point small x in capital X, then you know that the fundamental group of the base space can be identified with it can be identified with the Deck transformation group of the universal cover, okay, which is subgroup of automorphisms. Let me just say homeom, I will just put automorphisms of the universal covering space. Of course, you know, if this is a holomorphic covering, okay, then this will be a holomorphic automorphisms and everything will be holomorphic. If it is just a topological covering, then these are all just homeomorphisms, alright. And now what I am going to do is I am going to twist the covering by an automorphism of the universal cover, okay. So what I am going to do is the following. Choose a phi which is an automorphism of the universal covering, okay. Then you see X to X sub unit P, this is a covering, alright. Then what I will do is I will put this phi here and I will consider this map which is a composition, first apply phi inverse, then apply P, okay. Now what will happen is that this will also be a covering map, this will also be a universal covering. After all, this is an isomorphism and this is a covering. An isomorphism followed by a covering is also a covering, so this is also a covering. But this is again simply connected, so it is also the universal covering. So this is also another avatar of the universal covering, alright. Now what will happen is, because of this, the fundamental group of X will also be identified here, okay. And there is a difference in these two identifications. That difference arises because of this automorphism phi, and what that difference is, it is actually conjugation by phi, okay. So that is what I want you to realize. So this will give rise to a diagram like this. So I have the fundamental group of capital X based at small x. So I fix a point small x in capital X, and this is identified with the Deck transformation group of this covering X univ P X, okay. And this identification is because of this covering, okay. Now this covering will give me another identification. So what I will have here is I will also have Deck transformations of the other covering, that is X sub univ to, now this covering is P followed by phi inverse, okay. So there is also an identification like this, okay. So this covering gives me identification of the fundamental group of X with the Deck transformation group of this cover, and similarly this covering gives me an identification of X, identification of the fundamental group of X with the Deck transformation group of this covering, okay. And what is this map? This map is just the isomorphism that sends any F to, you know, phi inverse followed by F followed by phi, okay. So it's very clear. See, if you give me a Deck transformation here, something that permutes the decks here, how do I get one here? I go by phi inverse, apply this Deck transformation and then apply phi. That's how this is related. So what this tells you is that if you change the universal cover, okay, by an automorphism of the universal covering space, okay, the top space, the covering space, then the Deck transformation group will change by a conjugate, where it will change by a conjugate subgroup in the group of automorphisms of the universal cover. So what this will tell you is, thus Deck, the Deck transformation of X to P composed with phi inverse X sub univ to X is a conjugate of, you see, the Deck transformation group of the original cover in the group of automorphisms of the universal cover, okay. So the, in other words, you know, this is merely one should say philosophically a reflection of the fact that, you see, the fundamental group will change by a conjugate if you change the base point, okay. So what you do is the same kind of thing happens above. If you change the covering by an automorphism of the top space, okay, then the Deck transformation group will change by a conjugate, okay. So if you remember this, it's very very easy to actually see that this translation by any omega is conjugate to translation by 1 in the full group of automorphisms of C, okay. So so what I want to say is that translation by omega is conjugate to translation by 1 in automorphisms of C, which is P delta 2C, okay, which is, of course, you know, the set of all matrices of the form A, B, these are all just translations, A, B, 0, C, such that A, B, 0, D, such that A, D equal to 1, modulo plus or minus identity 2, identity matrix, okay. And how do you prove this? It's very simple. So let me write that down. So see, you just solve for such a transformation, okay. So what you do is solve for A, B, 0, D with A, D equal to 1. A, B, 0, D, if you conjugate that with translation by omega, which is given by 1 omega 0, 1, and if I put A, B, 0, D inverse, I want to get 1, 1, 0, 1, which is translation by 1, okay. So you can solve for this, you will get A, B, 0, D to be of, you can, it's a simple calculation. What you'll get is, let me write it down, it is just going to be 1 by root omega B, 1 by root omega B 0 root of omega, okay, where B is any complex number, any any such, mind you, omega is non-zero, so it has a square root. Choose any one square root, there are two square roots, and you take 1 by root omega and root omega here, okay. Now this is clearly determinant 1 and this is a Mobius transformation, okay. So now let me call this Mobius transformation as phi, okay. Let me call phi to be this Mobius transformation. Then phi is what? Phi is an automorphism of C, which is the universal covering, alright. So now look at this, you have C, okay, and you have P and you have X, okay, and then I apply this phi here, I have this automorphism of C, okay, and here I get the other covering, just like there I get P circle phi inverse, this diagram commutes, okay. Now the moment this diagram commutes, you are going to have an identification of a Dirac transformation group with the Dirac transformation of group with of this with the Dirac transformation group of group with this, and what it will tell you, see, that will tell you that Dirac transformation group of C P X is this group, if you conjugate it by phi, you get that group, okay. So phi, so let me write that, so I will write it as phi circle Dirac circle phi inverse is actually Dirac transformation of C to this is P circle phi inverse, okay. I will get this, okay, and in other words what I will get is phi circle, this is z dot t omega is just z dot t sub 1, okay. So that means that for this covering you are actually going modulo translations by 1, okay, and if you are going modulo translations translations by integer multiples of 1, which is just translation by integers, okay, and if you are going modulo translations by integers, then this covering is the same as is isomorphic to the covering z going to e exponential of 2 pi I z, because this is the map when you are going modulo translations by integer multiples of omega. If omega is 1, then this covering map will be just z going to exponential of 2 pi I z. So what this will tell you is that this guy is isomorphic to the covering C to C star, which is given by z going to exponential of 2 pi I z, okay, because here the Dirac transformation group is just translation by integer multiples of 1, translation by integers. So the moral of the whole story is take any Riemann surface whose universal cover is C, the complex plane, and assume that the fundamental group is isomorphic to Z, then that covering itself, not only is the Riemann surface isomorphic to C star, but the covering itself is isomorphic to this specific covering, okay. So this is this unique representative for all possible covering spaces of holomorphic structures on a real cylinder, Riemann surface structures on a real cylinder, okay. So so that ends it, and finally let me look at the third case, the last and final case, namely when G is isomorphic to Z dot omega 1 plus Z dot omega 2, you know that in this case we are going to get a complex torus, okay. So if G is Z dot translation by omega 1 plus Z dot translation by omega 2, then C P X is identified, is isomorphic to C mod Z dot translation by omega 1 plus Z dot translation by omega 2, which is Riemann surface structure on a torus, on a real torus. Okay. So this is the third case. So the moral of the story is, whenever the universal covering of Riemann surface is the complex numbers, then either it is that Riemann surface is either the complex numbers itself, or it is C star, and the covering is just given by the exponential map. Okay, or it is a Riemann surface structure on a complex torus. Okay, and these three cases corresponding, they correspond to the fundamental group of the Riemann surface being 0, or isomorphic to Z, or isomorphic to Z cross Z. Okay, so that is the, that was the classification theorem that I gave earlier. Okay, and this is the proof. Okay, so you can appreciate the elements of topology and covering spaces coming into the picture. Okay, yeah, so I will stop here.